Matthew Pearson. And Dr. Matthew Pearson, he is the Research and Evaluation Specialist at Living Water International in the Program Excellence Group. He has a PhD in economics from UC Davis, and he will be speaking on long-run WASH, monitoring progress, measuring impact, and encouraging sustainability in rural water, sanitation, and hygiene.
Well, you can see that I have shortened the title of my talk because in 10 minutes I barely have time to say it, much less tell you about all those things. So I'm sorry to disappoint if you're expecting to hear about all of it. Is there a way that I can like have this appear full screen? I don't. There you go. That's great. Thank you. So first I'll tell you a little bit about what we do at Living Water International. It's a Houston-based international NGO. We're 23 years old, so we've been around for a while. We're a faith-based organization. We operate currently in 24 countries, and to date we've done over 12,000 water projects. But those projects aren't all functioning. We don't know exactly how many, but based on several studies, we do know that at any given time, about 50% of water points in sub-Saharan Africa are broken. So the work that we're doing isn't lasting. And we're learning about what influences the long-run sustainability of water projects. And so I realized when I went to my first public health conference a few months ago, because as you heard, my background is in economics. And so I was surprised to see that a lot of the work that's going on in your field now is addressing the same issue of sustainability of these types of projects, and so I learned a lot from what you're doing at this conference recently, and so I wanted to share with you what we're learning in this process. So in order to address this, in 2011, Living Water launched a global strategic plan in an effort to address several issues, but this is one of them. How do we ensure sustainability? We know it doesn't start with water. Water projects break. If we haven't prepared a community to deal with that, with those issues, it's not going to fix itself, essentially. Sanitation projects require a lot of maintenance. Hygiene training, behavior change is one of the most challenging things we do. But sustainability does start with community. There are several aspects to this. A sustainable project needs to respond to need and demand. So it's not enough to go and install a water point where we think that a water point is needed. There has to be local demand. We've heard several times from communities where we go to work, please don't give us another borehole. The water tastes terrible. It's not appropriate in this area. If there's no demand there to use and maintain a water point, it's not going to last. So we need to be sensitive to that. The financing for the project has to be carefully planned. A community needs ownership. They need to be able to maintain and repair the water point when it breaks. And without careful planning of the financing, when the breakage occurs, and there's not adequate finances to repair it, it won't get fixed. The community needs to manage their water point as a community resource themselves. This is another aspect of ownership. And they need ongoing support. So this is one of the things that was discussed among many of the public health professionals in the research that I've seen lately. Ongoing support from repair and maintenance professionals, parts availability, and a functioning supply chain. These are vital for sustainable projects. So this global strategic plan I mentioned that launched in 2011 directed our Africa regional office to develop a regional strategy. And in that regional strategy, they in turn directed the individual field country offices to develop their own multi-year country strategy. So this came from the field, from our field professionals who are knowledgeable about the areas in which they work and could develop a strategy that came that was demand-driven as opposed to donor-driven. And so the multi-year country strategies included something we call a WASH program area, or a WPA, which is great because it's an acronym within an acronym. WASH meaning water, sanitation, and hygiene, WPA, WASH program area. And it is a geographically concentrated long-term investment in an area that is a comprehensive intervention that includes water, sanitation, hygiene, sustainability, training, includes engagement with local churches. It is demand-driven and not donor-driven. So we're no longer going all over a large geographic area. We're over an entire country driven by the desires of a donor or what seems like the greatest need in a certain area. We're choosing to focus tightly and for a long period of time on a much smaller geographic area and committing to bring water, sanitation, and hygiene access levels up to a certain standard. So we set targets based on where they are. So for instance, if 50% of the communities in the WASH program area have access to a safe water source, we may commit to bring that level up to 80 or 90% before we leave the program area. And so this WPA was piloted starting in 2010 in southwest Uganda. So this area in the map is the Ntungamo district. The bottom, the south part of the district there is the Rwanda border. So this is extreme southwest Uganda. We chose this area as a pilot for several reasons. One of which was that we had begun a couple of years prior to engage this area in their schools. So we had completed about 80 water points in schools all over this region. So we had an established presence. We had been there for a while, so the communities, because we'd be asking a lot of them compared to what we had done before, we had a demonstrated commitment to an area, but we were also changing the strategy a bit. The interventions that we had done in schools were less demanding of those communities. And so we wanted to know, can we go back and re-engage communities where we've worked before or where other NGOs have worked before and it, with another strategy, and would that work? What would the response to that be? We solicited applications from multiple communities and chose six of them to begin the first stage of the WPA pilot. We've since expanded this, but this was this is where these lessons are coming from, these initial six communities. And so we chose these six communities after receiving applications from community-based organizations, and we had the following requirements. It had to be from an existing community-based organization. So we wanted a track record evidenced by them being recognized by the local government. They had to have existing bylaws and a board. And they needed institutional representation from local churches and schools. We also required that they include a recommendation from the local council, preferably the mayor, minutes from the last three meetings, so we wanted an established track record. And we asked for evidence of healthy finances, so their bank statements and financial records. In turn, Living Water International Uganda agreed to construct fully subsidized water points, so we'd provide the initial capital investment. Coordinated community mobilization efforts for the work that was required from community members during the process. We agreed to coordinate hygiene and sanitation programs for a minimum of 2 years. We agreed to monitor and evaluate for a minimum of 2 years, which we are working to expand now. And we agreed to provide the operation and maintenance for the first 3 months. So this is sort of like a warranty, essentially. But it also gave the CBO time to build up a healthy account with the user fees that they'd begin collecting on the front end. The CBO, for their part, agreed to hold monthly meetings to maintain and improve the water points, to establish a tariff system so they would set the fees themselves, and to collect those fees. They also agreed to subsidize the lowest income households. So while we think it's important for a community to own and to maintain their water point, and part of that ownership includes paying for the water, we didn't want that to be a barrier for the lowest income households in the community. So we asked that they subsidize ones that couldn't afford to pay for it. But that was the CBO decided on their own how to handle that issue. They agreed to employ a community health worker. I was going to explain to you what that is, but I realized a few minutes ago that I don't have to. And they agreed to employ a water point caretaker. They also agreed to provide a training venue for us for the hygiene and sanitation programs to deal with any land ownership issues around the siting and construction of the water point. They agreed to protect the water point from vandalism, theft, and damage from animals. So this often included putting a fence around it. They agreed to monitor the functionality of the water point for the first 3 months and report breakdowns to us within 72 hours. And then after that initial 3-month warranty period, they agreed to take over the operation and maintenance. We also asked that they submit a 1-page annual report, and we provided the template for that report. So then, after the selecting of the communities, we implemented these interventions along parallel tracks. So I won't have time to go into this in detail, but we had a sustainability team that came in and began to train the community-based organization on financial management. Then they moved on to dealing with the financing of the operation and maintenance and water quality testing, then training the caretakers that were selected. And then on the water access track, hydrological and site surveys were the first step, and then preparing and drilling, water quality testing, installing the hand pump, et cetera. So these tracks proceeded concurrently. Here's what we learned. We can, in fact, re-engage communities with new approaches. They were responsive to this, so this was very encouraging to us. And the communities can and will take initiative if they're empowered. So giving them the local management, responding to their demand for a water point and coming in with appropriate technology so that if they didn't want a borehole because they had a spring that had water that was more palatable and had less iron in it, for instance, we would respond to that. They, in turn, were more responsive to us when they were empowered in this way. demand-driven site selection and technology works, but a qualified and experienced team is vital. So the kind of sustainability and hygiene and sanitation programs that we did, it no longer worked to do things the old way where we would train one person to go and do hygiene or to do a short hygiene program or, you know, giving the responsibility of sustainability training to a drilling team. That sort of thing didn't work. We needed qualified, trained, specialized teams of people to do this work. We had to carefully consider the size of the WPA and the baseline methods that we employed because if we wanted to show an impact on a geographic area, a geographic area that was too big was going to be far too difficult to determine anything with the types of evaluations that we can perform at our scale. Model communities create demand for and mentor other communities. So being responsive to demands from CBOs that are willing to meet the requirements that we had, if there were other communities in the area where the demand wasn't there, the model communities, the ones where the demand was there, where the CBOs were functional, would mentor other communities, and they would generate demand among those other communities. So having a concentrated geographic presence was helpful because it gave time for demand to be created from the local communities and not from us. But this requires a lot of planning. So we learned that we have to start planning early on. Just real quickly, some things that we're beginning to test, next steps. We're experimenting with a pilot program of real-time hand pump monitors. So this device, this is a prototype that connects to a 3G mobile signal and monitors the flow of the hand pump, tells us how much water is coming out of the ground, and tells us when it breaks. So this is exciting. We're also experimenting with sort of crowdsourcing the same type of monitoring. So instead of sticking an expensive device on a hand pump, we can put a sticker on there and collect data from SMS. Digital field data collection. So this is a team from a partner in the Central African Republic collecting data on an iPad, improving the quantity and quality of data that we collect. And then we're experimenting with supporting that supply chain with a company called Water Solutions that we've incubated in Nicaragua to provide the operation and maintenance for communities that are able to pay for the maintenance of their water points, but often for whom an adequate supply chain doesn't exist. So we spun off this company from Living Water, and it is a separate for-profit company that services the projects that we've installed. If you have questions, my email address is there, and I'd be happy to engage with you and continue this conversation via email. Thank you.